Let's do this. Will you stand to your feet? I'm going to pray. And let's pray for our nation. Let's pray for our leaders. Let's pray for those who are hurting and suffering and mourning. Let's pray for the churches all across the nation. And let's as well pray as we prepare to receive the word of the Lord today. I'm going to get down on my knees and let's go before the Lord together in prayer today. Father, we come to you in the mighty name of Jesus. And Lord, today as we remember, God, we lift up to you this nation, God. Specifically those who are hurting, God, those who are suffering, those who are mourning, God, that just as the sufferings of Christ have come over into our lives, God, so also would your comfort. Holy Spirit, wrap the everlasting arms around all those who have lost loved ones and friends and family members, God. Wrap your arms around those who are survivors, God, who are suffering post-traumatic stress, God. We pray, Lord God, that you would settle their hearts, God. Give them peace, God. Quiet every question, Lord. And Father, give them the knowledge of our Savior and our Lord Jesus Christ, God. Bring about salvation this day, we pray, Lord. God, empower the churches, God. We bless each and every one of those churches in New York and in the surrounding states and areas, God, that are housing people who were directly affected by this tragedy, Father God. And those who have scattered to the ends of the earth, God, if they've moved away because it's just too painful, too hard, God. Give those pastors and their leaders wisdom on what to say and a word in season today, Father. We pray for it in Jesus' name. God, we would ask for our nation to be protected, God. You said the angel of the Lord encamps about those that fear him. God, there are more than 10 righteous in this nation that fear your name. And so, God, we thank you, Lord, that tragedies are halted, that terrorism is stopped, that you bring about justice, God, and thwart the plan of the enemy. We call for the salvation of ISIS and ISIL and the Muslims and the terrorists around the world, God. We call for their salvation. We pray that the gospel goes forth to the nations, Lord, and that you send laborers into the harvest fields, God, not loving their lives even to death, God, that they should proclaim the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ, and that those terrorists be saved, just like Saul of Tarsus, who terrorize the church, be converted to Paul, the great apostle, Lord. We know that you can do it today. And so we ask you for it in the name of Jesus. As well, God, we pray for our land. God, we pray for our leaders. Lord, give us leaders who have a heart after your own heart, God. And Lord, whoever takes that office next, God, we pray for them. God, we pray that they would hear your voice and follow you. And that, God, the king's hand is in the heart of the Lord. The king's heart is in the hand of the Lord. You direct it like a water course wherever you desire. And so we pray, God, that you would turn it to bring about your goodness, to bring about the gospel, to bring about your praise and your glory on the earth. And Father, we love you and we give you praise. We thank you today, God, as we open your word, that you open our eyes to see, our ears to hear, open our hearts to have good understanding. May we be the good ground where the word is sown today. May it produce fruit in each and every one of our individual lives. Holy Spirit, you are the teacher. We recognize you. We acknowledge you. We welcome you, Lord. Come and speak to us today. In Jesus' mighty name, we're all in agreement. We say, amen. Amen. All right, you may have a seat. Today, get your Bibles out and go with me to Hebrews, the 12th chapter. We have started a series a couple weeks back in Hebrews chapter 12, verse number 1. Pastor Luke launched us into a series called Running the Race. And in classic Rock Church World Outreach Center style, we are taking our time, 3 weeks, and this is our third week, and we haven't even got out of the first verse yet. But you know, the Word of God is not meant to be fast food. The Word of God is meant to be good food. It's solid. It's healthy. You ever ate fast food and made you feel sick and you wondered why you gobbled it down so fast, you were so hungry, you devoured it, right? Well, see, the Word of God is not meant to be just devoured, even though it'll bless you, even though you can receive it in large quantities. The Word of God is meant to be not just devoured, it's meant to be digested, it's meant to be chewed on, it's meant to be something that is good, that you get every bit of nutrition and nourishment out of it that you can. Now, today we're going to be talking about a subject that's maybe not so comfortable. Maybe you're going to be going more ouch and more oh me than you do amen, all right? And so I want to encourage you today that, listen, no matter what happens, no matter what the Spirit of God speaks to you, that you just have a heart that says, you know what, Lord, I am ready to receive. That this is not just the words of a man. This is the very Word of God as we go into the message today. We're going to cover the topic because the Bible says in Hebrews the 12th chapter, verse number 1, therefore we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us. And let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. Now, you remember in part number 1, we talked about the fact that we are surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses. That the stands are filled all the way up to the nosebleed sections. And there are men and women of faith who have gone before us and they have modeled this. And what they're shouting at us is, you can do it. You've got it. You can go for it. Come on, stand in faith. Doesn't matter if you messed up, get back up and run your race. That they are like the 12th man for the Seahawks fans, right? And they're in the grandstands and they're shouting, go, 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 go. You can do it. Then we also learned last week when we were together, we talked about the weight. that we are to lay aside weights, that, yeah, there's black and white, but you know what, there's also gray areas. And they may not necessarily be bad for our lives, but are they beneficial for us? It might be something that it's okay, you know, and we could do those things in the natural, but really, is that going to be holding us back when we run our race? And today we're going to talk about the sin which so easily ensnares us. Now, I need to make a disclaimer on this message before we go any further, okay? A couple of disclaimers just so that you know what we're talking about. First disclaimer is this. Number one thing that you need to know as we go into the message today is I am not preaching down to you. I am not perfect. I am in this with you. And as we talk about sin, I'm not going to be talking to you about sin because I'm so holy, I'm so perfect, I've got it all together, and I'm preaching down at you so that you feel bad and you walk out of this place broken, defeated. No, listen, I'm in the same boat with you, and I'm doing the same thing. I may be anointed to preach and to teach the Word of God, but I am no more anointed to preach and to teach than I am to live it, all right? I have to live this thing out. I have to work at this. I have to work hard at doing the Word of God just like you do. Okay? Second disclaimer is this, is that I have not been listening into your bedroom conversations. I did not bug your house. I wasn't hiding in the back seat of your car. I didn't send spies to the workplace to find out what was going on at the water cooler. All right? So I don't know what's going on in your life. All right? So when I'm preaching about something, if I start talking about something, the Holy Spirit starts pointing something out, don't get mad at the preacher today, okay? Because I didn't say nothing. I didn't see nothing. This is something between you and God. And if you start feeling that, just say, okay, yes, Lord. Okay, Jesus. He's talking about me right now. Amen. All right? Don't be ashamed. Don't be bashful. Don't be shy. God wants to speak to your life today, and it's good. You know what? Sometimes things that don't really feel good are the right things for us. And there's times where you may not necessarily like what's going on, and, you know, might rub you the wrong way today. But you know what? If that's the case, if it's rubbing you the wrong way, then you need, if you're rubbing the cat the wrong way, turn the cat around, right? And it'll be all good, all right? So, you guys good with that? All right, praise the Lord. The sin was so easily ensnares us. See, sin is easy. The Bible tells us that sin has its pleasure for a season. It's easy for us to slip back into old ways, isn't it? It's okay to say yes, it is, because we all struggle in many things. We all struggle with sin. In fact, the original language, if you look it up in your Bible, you find out the original language talks about comfortable surroundings. Old King James says it easily besets us, that this is something that is common to us. This is something that feels good. You know, like on a cold morning when you're in bed and you had that cozy bed all wrapped up around you, you just didn't want to get out of bed, right? And you knew you needed to get up, and you knew you needed to iron the clothes, you knew you needed to get responsible and adult, but you couldn't adult today, right? Because it just feels so good in those comfortable surroundings. See, that's what it's talking about, the sin which so easily ensnares. It's almost like those fuzzy handcuffs, right, that you put on your legs as shackles. You will not be able to run no matter how comfortable you are in those shackles. They're going to hinder your race. They're going to stop you from running. Now, we know that God does not want us to sin. You guys missed a really good place to say amen. We know that God does not want us to sin. Amen. There it is. All right. And yet we still do. But Jesus said more than once, go and sin no more. Did he not? Right? He said that on multiple occasions. Go and sin no more. Well, that shows me that it's possible. Because Jesus would not have said it unless it really was possible. Because God doesn't mix words. In fact, if you read your Bible, you'll find out we've been freed from sin. We've been forgiven of all of our sin. We have been redeemed. We've been bought back. We've been bought out of the slavery of sin. That is our present reality that we live in as believers today. And yet the Bible tells us in the book of James, we all stumble in many things. That we are all fighting against and warring against sin. That if you read the book of 1 John, you almost kind of wonder if John knows what he's talking about at times, because in one verse, he'll be telling you that those who are the Lord's, those who have been born again, do not sin. Indeed, they cannot. But then he goes on and says, if anybody says, I don't have any sin, that he's a liar and he's making God out to be a God. Which one is it, John? I mean, come on, man. What are you talking about here? Really, what John's talking about is those that have been born again, that now we do not continue in the habitual practice of sin, that we're not working at it, we're not unrepentant and staying in our sin. That's what he's talking about. See, we must understand that this sin issue that separated us from God has been dealt with at the cross, and we've been forgiven, and we've been given a new nature. Now, let me define it to you in terms like this, okay? Let's talk about faith for a second. Let's get off of sin for a second, get on faith, right? So when you read your Bible, you'll find that there are a couple different types of faith, right? There is the faith, okay, which when we read in the Bible the faith, many were added to the faith. What is it really talking about? Well, it's talking about our Christian beliefs, right? It's talking about the fact that we believe that Jesus died on the cross, and therefore, if I will give him all my heart and all my life, if I am born again, now I am a part of the faith. I'm a part of Christianity, right? And that's what the Bible refers to when it talks about the faith in the broad general sense, okay? But also we understand that I can believe God for specific promises with the faith, right? Because I can understand the word of God, I can believe that I receive it, and I can put my faith out there for provision. I can have the faith for my healing. I can have the faith for my marriage. I can have the faith for my children. So we understand that there's the broad general, the faith, right? We're all a part of the faith, but when I put the faith out there for something, it's a specific thing. It's the same thing when we take a look at sin. You will find there are times in the Bible where it talks about sin. You were sold under sin. You were a slave to sin. It is a broad general term. But then later on, and at times, it talks about the sin that we battle, the sin that we struggle against, the sin that we strive against, the specific things in our lives that will hold us back and weigh us down. See, even though we've been delivered from sin, we still struggle with sin. Everybody get what I'm talking about? See, we still live in a fallen world. The devil is still out there alive and well, wreaking havoc. And we're still weak in the flesh that fights against our spirit, and our minds are having to be renewed. See, we don't understand this. We are a three-part being. Just like God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, there's three parts to our being. There is body, soul, and spirit. The spirit man is the real you, okay? You are a spirit that has a soul. You have a mind, a will, and emotions, okay? And you are housed in a body, in this flesh suit. When you are born again, your spirit is renewed. You are born again. You're brand new. Your mind has to be renewed. That's your understanding. That's your knowledge, okay? And the house of your spirit and your soul, that's called your heart. When you read in the Bible about the heart, the conscience, that's the voice of your soul and spirit. That's the voice that comes. It's your conscience. It comes in your heart, okay? The deepest part of your being. But then you live in a body that will be renewed. When you go to be with Jesus or when he comes for you, you will receive a new body. Oh, glory, someday we're going to get out of this sinful flesh and we get to be with Jesus, okay? So when we talk about sin, we know that the flesh is warring against the spirit, and that when we choose to do the wrong thing, that now we have sinned. Now, we've got to define for ourselves, what does sin mean? Sin means this. Sin means to violate a rule, to cross a line, to commit a grievance, or to miss the mark. Okay, let me say that again. Sin means to violate a rule, to cross a line, to commit a grievance, or to miss the mark. So when you know what to do, and you don't do it, sin. You have violated the rule. But wait a second, I thought that we were no longer under rules. I thought that we were under grace. No, there is now the law of love. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Love your neighbor as yourself, right? This is the new commandment. This is the new rule. This is the new law. And therefore, if we love God, we will not put anything before him, will we? See, that's why love is the fulfillment of the law, is because those Ten Commandments, if you're operating in love, you don't need it any longer. Because if you love God, you won't create an image and bow down before it. If you love God, you will not put anything before him. If you love God, you will not use his name in vain, right? Right? Okay, you got to track with me, guys. Got to make sure that you're still here, all right? This is an interactive sermon today, all right? If you love your neighbor as yourself, then you will not murder him. Somebody ought to say amen, right? That just makes sense. I love him, I won't kill him. Okay, I might slap him, but nah, not going to kill him. If you love your neighbor, you won't commit adultery with their spouse. Hello? If you love somebody, you're not going to steal from them. It just makes sense, doesn't it? So when we willfully violate the law, when we go against the law that's in our hearts, now it's written on our hearts, and our conscience, the voice of our conscience said, mm-mm, don't do that. And you decide to do it anyway? Sin. When we cross the line, we know it. Ah, I shouldn't have done that. Sin. Right? When we commit a grievance, what does that mean? That means there are things that you can do that the world says is acceptable. It says truth is fluid. Whatever truth is for them is their truth, and whatever truth is for you is your truth. No, truth is consistent regardless of our experience and regardless of our understanding of it. I don't understand electricity and how it works, but if I touch it, it will shock me. Right? Oh, I didn't understand it though. Yeah, but you're a dummy. You still touched it. It still shocked you. See, it doesn't matter your experience. It doesn't matter. See, what matters is it or isn't it? See, truth, regardless of who you are, is consistent. And there are things that we can do that the world would say, totally fine, you're good, it's not sin. But it grieves the heart of God. And when you do it, you know the Holy Spirit has backed off of you. And you can sense that there's been that breach. See, that's sin. Or to miss the mark. To miss the mark. Now, I was raised in a conservative Christian environment, and I was taught growing up, early in my Christian walk, that sin is simply missing the mark. We're sinful. We're in the flesh. You're going to miss the mark. You're going to mess up. And I always wrote that off. Well, then it's okay, because I'm in the flesh. Nobody's perfect, right? But that's actually wrong thinking. Let me illustrate this for you for a second, okay? Up on the overheads behind me, I have an image of an archery target, okay? And that archery target, the goal is, the rules are, that you are to take your bow and arrow and you're to shoot, and what you want to try and do is hit the very center. You want to try and hit the bullseye, okay? That would be the most points. But you can shoot and you can hit that target anywhere and still be playing by the rules. So let me show this to you. Let's say, okay, in my understanding, it used to be like this. I'd take my bow and arrow in my life and I would lean it back in 3, 2, 1, let go. Psh, all right. Whoops, I sinned. I didn't hit the bullseye. I thought I sinned. I missed the mark. But listen, just because you're not perfect doesn't mean that you sinned. Because in archery, if you're playing by the rules, that's still acceptable. Let's say I'm just going throughout my life. It's a windy day, and I'm just going for it. I'm going fast, and I just, right? Okay. But as long as I'm playing by the rules, I'm behind the line, I'm aiming at it, I'm shooting, right? Even though that may happen, and I never hit the bullseye, I still haven't sinned. Say, how does that work? How does that work? You missed the mark. I didn't hit the bullseye. I wasn't perfect, but I still haven't sinned. See, 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 5, and also if anyone competes in athletics, he is not crowned unless he competes according to the rules. See, in that archery illustration, I played according to the rules. I was focused on the target I aimed, and I shot, and even though I might have missed the bullseye, I still was playing according to the rules, okay? Now remember, Hebrews chapter 12, we're talking about running the race. Let's get a racetrack up on the overheads, okay, for our understanding of this, okay? This is a racetrack. Let's say that this racetrack is 1 mile if you run all the way around it, okay? There's a certain place that you're going to start, and then there's a finish line that you, as you go around, that you're going to cross. If you compete according to the rules, you'll be crowned, all right? Let's see the rules. You have to stay in your lane. See the green line? Okay, so you start at the starting point. If you run all the way around this oval, 1 mile, if you're the first one to cross, you win. Now, let's say while I'm running, I decide, I don't like this track. I don't like my lane. In fact, the grass looks like it would be better for my feet. And let's say my race looks like this blue line, right? I decide I'm going to go say hi to some of my family in the stands. I'm going to run over here. I'm going to do my little loop-de-loop there in the center, my little victory lap. And let's say that as I'm running my race on that blue line, that I run the race the fastest. I did a mile the fastest. I beat everybody in my time. Am I going to be crowned? Why am I not going to be crowned? I didn't compete according to the rules. See, sin is not just missing the mark in the sense that I didn't hit the bullseye. Sin is willful disobedience to the rules. If we go back to our archery illustration, if I was shooting this way and decided that I didn't like the guy next to me and I aimed at him and I shot him down, that would be sin, right? Because I willfully disobeyed. The rules is you shoot the target, not your brother, right? So in our illustration here, we understand this, that I have willfully disobeyed. I have gotten off of the goal and now I have wandered from my lane, from where God had outlined for me to go. And even though I might run a mile in the fastest time, I will not be crowned because I have not played according to the rules. I have sinned. Everybody understands what we're talking about. See, when we willfully disobey and violate the rules, we have sinned and we have missed the mark. Laying aside sin is a matter of exercise and of execution. Laying aside sin is a matter of exercise and execution. 1 Corinthians chapter number 9, turn there with me. The Apostle Paul is writing to the Corinthian church. Now, Corinth was near to Greece, okay? Corinth would have understood the Olympic Games. Corinth would have known about competition and would have understood athletic terminology. 1 Corinthians chapter number 9, towards the end of the chapter, you'll find verse 24. We're going to read through verse number 27. 1 Corinthians chapter number 9, verse 24 starts out and he says this: "Do you not know that those who run in a race all run, but one receives the prize? Run in such a way that you may obtain it." In other words, you're going to be running a race, and you know who you're competing against? Yourself. And therefore, he says, you're going to have to run in a way that you obtain the prize. What does that look like? Next verse goes on. Verse 25, "And everybody who competes for the prize is temperate in all things." Now, we don't often use that word temperate, but we do use the word temperature. A temperature is how hot or how cold the environment is, right? So if you are the one that is to be temperate, you are to set the gauge of the thermostat of your life. In other words, if you are running way too hot, but God said, "I want you right here," then it's time to turn it down, okay? God says, be angry and do not sin. He lists one of the sins as outburst of wrath. Do not use profane language. You will find that in the New Testament, my friends. So if you're running too hot, it's time to turn it down. But also, there are things that maybe we're running too cold, and it's time to turn the heat up. Jesus said, do not let your love grow cold. And maybe you haven't been operating in love. Maybe you've been distancing yourself. Maybe you've been ignoring your family. And to you, it's sin because you know that that's not the good God has called you to do. And therefore, God says, I want you to turn it up in some areas. Maybe you've been ignoring God and you've let your love grow cold and you have wandered from the faith. And God's saying, I want you to turn that back. I want you to be temperate in all things. You know what that speaks of? That speaks of a discipline in our lives. Let's look at it. Goes on and says, now they do it to obtain a perishable crown, but we for an imperishable crown. Let me ask you this question. Which one's more important? Thank you, sir. Everybody knows the answer. Now, which one's more important? Imperishable, right? The perishable crown is something that's going to fade away, something that's only lasting here on the earth. In fact, at the time, they would use a laurel. You've seen, Caesar and some of those guys back in the day in Greece. They would put a wreath or a crown that was made out of twisted different plants, things like that, flowers, or they'd have that kind of garland that would go around there. When you think about that, first day, it looks great, right? Second day, the leaves start kind of withering down a little bit, a little saggy, but you could still sport it. You could still wear it. Third day, leaves are falling off, all that kind of stuff. And then by the fourth day, your wife threw it away, and she's like, I don't even know why you keep that thing around the house. Any men can say amen to that, right? She threw away your favorite pants. That's just me. All right, praise the Lord. Verse 26, therefore I run thus. See, we're running a race, and if we're going to run the race, there's a way that we need to run. And he says, therefore I run thus, not with uncertainty. Blue line. You guys remember that? Right? Not with uncertainty. He says, I run the green line. I know exactly the course. I know exactly where I'm going. I know where the finish line is. I know where the goal is. I run thus, not with uncertainty. Look at what he says. Thus I fight. Not as one who beats the air. Now, a lot of commentators think about this. I'm not just shadow boxing. This is not just me warming up. I'm in a fight. No, listen. If you are in a fight, he says, thus I fight. That means there is an opponent that he is squaring off with, right? And so he says, thus I fight, not as one who beats the air. If you're in a boxing match and you're beating the air, you're losing. Hello? So here you are, and you're going, trying to hit him, trying to get him in the gut, trying to punch, doing the jab, doing the cross. You got the hook going, you got the uppercut. But if you're beating the air, that means the other guy's like this. just waiting for a moment for you to be vulnerable, and then bang, he's going to lay you out on the floor. You're going to be kissing the mat. He says, thus I fight, not as one who beats the air. I know my target, I know my goal, and I'm competing according to the rules. Verse 27, but I discipline my body. Oh, don't you hate that verse? I do. No one wants to discipline their body, right? No one wants to say no. And yet, if you're going to compete according to the rules, there has to be some discipline. You're going to have to say no to some food. You're going to have to say no to some sleep. You're going to have to say no to some comfort. You're going to have to say yes to pain. Say yes to denying yourself. Say yes to standards. Say yes to rules. See, we think in our society it's such a bad thing. It's not a bad thing. This is a good thing. Why? Because you will receive what's important, which is the crown of life in eternity, the crown of righteousness in eternity. To him who overcomes, I will give. See, and not to the ones who don't run the race and don't finish. No, to the ones who overcome, to the ones who play according to the rules, now you will receive that. See, it's a matter of execution and exercise. Thus I discipline my body and bring it into subjection, lest when I have preached to others, I myself should become disqualified. See, even the Apostle Paul puts himself in the same boat as us. We would think, man, this is the great apostle. No, he says, listen, guys, I can mess up too. I can sin too. That's why I discipline myself. Because I don't want to be disqualified from the game. I want to obtain the prize. Come on, somebody. Isn't that good? See, your faith is the exercise. And your works are the execution. What you believe, what you know of the Word of God that you receive as the truth will be lived out in your life. You have to know the rules and then play by them. It's that simple. You have to know the rules and then play by them. See, in the book of Hebrews chapter 12, it's told that we are to lay aside the sin which so easily ensnares us, those comfortable surroundings. Come on, throw the covers off. Get away from those things that are easy to slip back into. You remember the whole book of Hebrews, we've been talking about this from chapter 3. It talked about do not go into unbelief because the children of Israel did not enter into the promised land. Why? Because they did not believe and therefore they did not obey. So the exercise is your faith, right? It says that the word that they heard didn't profit them, not being mixed with, not being exercised with faith. Therefore, they never did anything about it, and they sinned, and they could not enter into the promised land. They never received the goal of their faith. See, the sin starts with the sin of unbelief. And whatever you are unbelieving about, you will violate the rules of. Let me give you an example of this. The Apostle Paul in Romans chapter 14, verse number 23. Okay, I'm going to read it to you in the J.B. Phillips translation. Okay, this is a paraphrase that he wrote. And in J.B. Phillips, Romans chapter 14, verse 23, he's talking about eating meat or not eating meat. There were people who said, it's not right, you shouldn't eat meat. Other people said, it's okay, it's fine. We got chapter and verse in Genesis, and they went and they had a barbecue. Okay? And so some of them are saying, you're in sin for eating meat. Other ones are saying, well, wait a second, my conscience is clear. I can eat meat. And so they're going back and forth. And the Apostle Paul says in Romans chapter 14, verse 23, in the J.B. Phillips paraphrase, yet if a man eats meat with an uneasy conscience about it, you may be sure he is wrong to do so. For his action does not spring from his faith. And when we act apart from our faith, we sin. The NIV states in this same verse, Romans chapter 14, verse 23, at the end of the verse, it says, everything that does not come from faith is sin. That means when you operate in unbelief, you are operating in sin. When we are unbelieving about any area of life, we will operate in sin. It means that you know where the finish line is and you willfully choose to run in a different direction. Playing in the grass, waving to the people in the bandstands, and you're missing the mark. Let me illustrate this for you. We know that the Bible says, do not fornicate. Can I meddle in someone's business for a second? I'm going to anyways. Whether you like it or not, just sit there and just stare ahead, okay? So you don't know, the pastor doesn't know he's talking about me right now. But listen, in our society, people say, it's fine. If it feels good, do it. That's old. You know, that's from back in the day. Times have changed. But you know the Word of God says, don't have sex outside of marriage. You know. And yet we choose to do it anyways. Well, we'll just live together and we'll be fine. We'll just share the same bed. We won't mess around. No, it's going to happen. Stop messing around. You know what the Bible says. And if you're going to burn with lust, better to get married than to burn. That's what the Bible says. And yet, we do it anyways. We know what the Bible says, but we're unbelieving. You know what the Bible says? The Bible says to not let any unclean communication proceed forth from your lips except that which is good for necessary edification. The things which you speak should build people up, not tear people down. And yet in our joking, yet in our cultures, can I meddle in culture for a second? This little white boy from Moreno Valley grew up and heard a lot of things from a lot of different people. It's okay for us to say, but it's not okay for you to say. Listen, it's not okay because you're tearing people down. I don't care what race you are. I don't care what culture you are. I don't care if you like me right now. I don't care if you're going to leave this church. Go find another church that'll tickle your ears because it's not going to be this place. I'm going to get in your face and tell you the truth because I love you and I don't want you to die and go to hell. That's the church that you attend. That's the church. This is an uncompromised gospel of Jesus Christ. And if you are using your words to tear down people, it doesn't matter if you have the same color skin or not. You're wrong and it's sin. Because the Bible says, and you are unbelieving. Think that doesn't apply to you. That's fine. Bring it up with God. I didn't write it, guys. Hello. We would have a lot less domestic disturbance calls if husbands were believing about what the Bible says about dwelling with your women with understanding. We would have a lot less divorce. We would have a lot less kids strung out and on drugs and trying to find a family if parents would read the Word of God and believe it. We would have a lot less prison sentences and a lot less people in the prisons if we would understand and be believing of the Word of God. And our nation would be a better place if the real church would stand up and call sin, sin, and call truth, truth, and not just lay back and let everybody do every stupid thing that comes into their minds and say, it's okay, it's fine, it's all good. No, it's sin and it's wrong, and we need to stop it. We need to change. You say, I don't know how to change, Pastor. Here's how. Romans chapter 6. Romans chapter 6. I tore you open. Let me sew you up. Romans chapter 6. Listen, I'm doing this because I love you. Jesus said, I didn't come for the righteous, I came for the unrighteous. It's not the healthy people who need a doctor. Listen, you guys came to the right place today. This is a hospital. There's blood all over the place. It's the blood of Jesus that mends and that heals. It's the blood of Jesus that takes care of sin. It's the blood of Jesus that gives you the strength and the grace and empowers you to live a godly life in Christ. You can do this. Jesus said it. Go and sin no more. It's possible, you guys. We got to make the right choices. Romans chapter 6, verse number 12. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal bodies. If he says do not let, that means it's a choice. Hello? Do not let sin reign in your mortal bodies, that you should obey it in its lusts. See, it starts with a desire, a strong desire. That's what lust is, strong, passionate desire. Ooh, I want that. That looks cozy. That looks comfortable. And then as that desire births something inside of you, it conceives sin on the inside of you. Sin gives birth to death. Do not let it. It's a choice. You choose. The desire in itself is not sinful. It's acting on that desire that now you have missed the mark because you know what the Bible says. So that desire might rise up in the flesh, and if you say no, you haven't sinned. But if you say, and you start heading that direction, now all of a sudden you have missed the mark. You've gone outside of the lines. Right? Everybody tracking with what we're talking about? Everybody's good. Do not let sin reign in your mortal bodies that you should obey it in its lusts. Verse number 13, and do not present your members as instruments of unrighteousness to sin, but present yourselves to God as being alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness to God. You have a choice every day of your life, every moment that you're presented with those lusts. What are you going to do? Are you going to allow your body to be an instrument of unrighteousness to death or of righteousness to life? What are you going to choose? And then the last verse, verse 14, for sin shall not have dominion over you, for you are not under the law, but under grace. Oh, grace, yes, grace covers all. It doesn't matter what I do anymore. No, that's not what this is talking about. And if you think that's what it's talking about, back up to verse number 1 and verse number 2, where it says, shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Certainly not. Let me read 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 16 in the Message. Exercise your freedom by serving God, not by breaking the rules. See, I don't think it can get any clearer than that. You weren't saved so that you can go out and sin and do whatever you want. No, you were saved for sanctification, being set apart for God as an instrument of righteousness, that you should show the world, that you should be temperate, that you should be a leader, that you should be the witness and the testimony that God is good and that God is graceful, that he empowers me and that I've overcome the sin. What does it boil down to? Know the rules and play by the rules. Know the rules and play by the rules. Pastor, I got a question. What do I do? Because I know I'm going to mess up. I know there's going to be a time where that desire, I'm running, and that desire, and I'm going to turn, and I'm going to miss the mark. What do I do? What do I do? Because I know it's coming. Here's what you do, okay? We're running, right? That's the goal. We're going with Jesus. All of a sudden, ooh, shiny, right? We turn around, and we start running the wrong direction. Here's what you do. You repent. What is repentance? Repentance means I'm going the wrong direction. I'm going to change my mind about what I'm aimed at. I'm going to turn 180 degrees from where I was headed, and I'm going to go in this direction back towards the goal where God is calling me to. And I'm going to run. That is what repentance is. I was going this direction. That's the wrong way. I'm going to repent and turn from my way, and I'm going to go God's way, and I'm going to run towards the mark that God has given me. That's repentance. What does it look like from the Word's perspective? 1 John chapter 1, verse number 9. If we confess our sins, God is faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. In other words, you're running this way, and as you're running this way, you got angry. Ooh, you got angry. Man, you started to sin. You let that word slip right out of your mouth. Ooh, I haven't used that word since high school. And you decided, whoop, wrong direction. And so you repent. What do? You say, God, I confess to you that I was angry and I sinned. Notice the Bible says that you should be angry and not sin. Anger in itself is not a sin. But don't tell me that word just slipped out of your mouth. That word crossed your mind before it crossed your lips. And you had a choice whether or not you were going to say it. Didn't just slip out. You know. I know, right? Because we all stumble in many things. You didn't just fall into the bed of adultery. Oh, whoops. Whoa. You laugh. Because you know it's not true. It starts with a thought. Man, I'm really mad at my wife, really mad at my husband. Hey, they're giving you some attention, then it turns into a text message. Then it turns into a hug. Then it turns into a kiss. Then it turns into an embrace. Then it turns into a plan. See, you do not just fall into sin. But as you realize, as you recognize, when it starts, I'm really angry, I'm not going to sin, I'm going to change my mind, I'm going to turn, God, I confess my sin to you, Lord, I messed up, God, I repent of my sin, I confess to you that I was wrong, I ask for your forgiveness, God, and I trust that you will cleanse me. You say, but I'm going to feel bad. Oh, thank God you feel bad. You know why? Because if you feel bad about it, you won't do it again. Hello? That's why the Bible says godly sorrow leads to repentance, which leads to everlasting life. When you feel bad about sin, not just guilty. Yeah, we're all guilty. We all know. I've sinned, I messed up, and I feel bad. Godly sorrow. In other words, if you can weep over your sin, if you can say, Lord, I'm sorry, I feel bad about missing the mark. I went the wrong direction, but God cleansed me. Next time that comes up, you're going to remember that feeling. And you're going to say, oh no, I like the feeling of fellowship with my Jesus more than I like the feeling of those comfortable surroundings, which lead to death. And little by little, it's an uphill battle. You will overcome in every area of your life. You will overcome that sin. And the things that you're struggling with today, at the level that you're struggling with them at, that will not be your struggle tomorrow. You will be on the up and up, and you will be dealing with things, and God will be refining you. He'll just be taking layers out little by little. Hey, we dealt with the mouth. Now let's deal with the heart. Now we dealt with the heart. Let's deal with the head, right? And God will keep working on you. And listen, till Jesus comes, he's going to be working on us. But for all of us, we need to lay aside, we need to choose each and every day to get rid of those comfortable surroundings, lay those hindrances aside, and run towards the mark of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. You guys get something from the Word today? I'm going to ask at this time, every head bowed, every eye closed, just take a moment. I want to give you a gift right now of a private moment with God. And ask no one to get up, no one to leave during this time, because I want to make sure that your heart and life is right with Jesus Christ. Just take a moment, close your eyes. I want to ask you a question there in the silence, there in the stillness, as every head is bowed, every eye is closed. I want to ask you today, if it was your last day, where would you end up? Just answer that question in your heart. No one will know the answer but you and God. We're not guaranteed tomorrow. 15 years ago, the people that got up, got dressed, went to work at the World Trade Center had no idea that it was going to be their last day on the earth. December 2nd of last year, on a cold Wednesday morning, people that got up and went to the IRC down the street from us had no idea 14 of them would no longer be with us. You are not guaranteed tomorrow. Young or old, it doesn't matter. Where would you end up? Would it be heaven or would it be hell? You're only going to be in one of those two places. Can't come back as a frog or a dog or work your way up through another lifetime. The Bible says it's appointed for man once to die and then to the judgment. And today, if you said, well, I don't know where I'd go. Maybe you said, I hope I would go to heaven. Some of you said, maybe. Some of you said, I really don't know. And some of you said, I know I wouldn't make it. Listen, if that's you in any of those categories I just described, I want you to listen up. Because that doesn't have to be your end. Today, you can make a choice here in this safe and friendly church service to make a decision to follow Jesus, to run your race, and head in the direction of heaven rather than in hell. God loves you so much, he sent Jesus, beaten, bloody, and hung on a cross, to open the way. But there is only one way to get to heaven, and that is that you must be born again. Now, I know our society's made a mockery of that term. They made it out to be some weirdo thing. And oftentimes we think that we can work our way up to that. Maybe we can attend enough church, or maybe if we're raised in church, or maybe we do a lot of good works that we can attain to salvation. But listen, it's not any of that. It simply means that you've given God all of your heart. You've given God all of your life. You've surrendered everything to Jesus. And that now you've received that free gift of God's heart and of God's life. Now spiritually, you've been born again, brand new, like we talked about today. If you're in this place today and you say, I know I need to do that. I know I need to give God all my heart. I know I need to give God all my life. I need to turn from my way that I was headed for hell, headed my own direction, doing my own thing instead of God's thing. Today is your day of salvation. Today you can turn and go God's way and run the race in the direction that he would have for you, headed for heaven, denying your presence in hell. I want to pray with those of you who need to make that change. And if you want to be included in that prayer, in a moment, I'm going to count to three just like this. One, two, three, and then I'm going to pop my hands together. Bang, just like that. And when you hear the sound of my hands popping together just like that, bang, that's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give God all my heart. I want to give God all my life. I want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up, and I'll acknowledge it. And today, you can be included in that prayer. After we see everybody who's raised their hands, then we're going to bring you forward and we'll pray a prayer of salvation together. And today you can change destinies. You can change directions. No longer headed for hell, but now headed for heaven. Who should raise their hand in a moment if you've been running from God instead of to God? I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand if you're not sure about your salvation? Today is your day. Make sure. Who should raise their hand if you've never done this before, never said yes to Jesus, given him all of your heart and all of your life? I'm speaking to you. Or finally, who should raise their hand in this place? If you're lukewarm in this place and that's the condition of your heart, then you need to do this, because Jesus said, I wish you were hot or cold, because if you're lukewarm, I will vomit from my mouth. It's gross, it's graphic words from the mouth of Jesus, but what's he saying, lukewarm, what's that all about? Well, it's a little in, little out, little up, little down, a little token prayer every now and again, an occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything, and you're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, if that's your relationship with Jesus, you're not going to make it, because only people that are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. Today is your day of salvation. Get ready to get your hand up when I count to three. Pop my hands together, and then you can come forward and pray that prayer today. All across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, wherever, God, I can see you guys. Both those family rooms are filled. If you're out there in the foyer or down at the Love Rock Cafe, come on, put the burger down. Get ready to get your hand up. If you're watching online, wherever you're at, across the nation and around the world, get ready to get your hand up. God sees, and God's watching right where you're at, too. I'm going to count to three. Pop my hands together. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Time to change destinies. Time to change directions. Time to give God all of your heart and all of your life. You can be saved today, headed for heaven. Here we go. Get ready to get your hands up. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me right now. There's one, two, three, four, five. Thank you. Six, thank you. Seven, got you over here. Who else today? Seven wise people already. There's seven wise people already. Anybody else? Eight up on top. Got you over there. Thank you. Nine on this side. Got you over there. Thank you. God bless you. Ten up on top. Got you right there. Who else today? Who else today? 10, 11. Got you right there. Thank you. God bless you. Anybody else that I did not already see? That I didn't already see? I got you over there. Thank you. All the way up on top. 12 on this side. Anybody else real quick? Anybody else right there? Got you over there. 13. Thank you. God bless you. Back in the family rooms. 13, 14. Thank you. Thank you. Who else today? Up on top over there. Yes, I got you right there. 15. God bless you. God bless you. Anybody else today that you say, I don't think you saw me yet, Pastor. I don't think you saw me, but I want to be included in that prayer today. If that's you, just raise it up high. Anybody else? Anybody else real quick? Anybody else real quick? Right over here. Thank you. Thank you. Got you. God bless you. Anybody else real quick? One more sweep through, and then we're going to pray together. Going to give it all your heart and all of your life. Going to be born again. Anybody else? Thank you. Got you up on top. Anybody else? All right, let's give the Lord a great big hand. About 16 wise people. Hallelujah. All 16 of you, 17 of you, 18 of you should have raised your hand, but you didn't. It's not too late. If you raise your hand, you should have raised your hand. You want to be included in that prayer. Like I said, we're going to bring you forward at this time. We're going to pray with you. Get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, a friend if you need a friend. Get in the aisle and meet me up front because we're going to change destinies today. Can't do that till we get you down here. So let's all stand and welcome them. And you come from the family rooms. If you raise your hand or your children raise your hand, bring them right now. This is their time. If you raised your hand, come on. From the foyer, if you're out there, come on. Wherever you're at, even if you didn't raise your hand, come on. Don't leave during this time. We're trying to get people come forward. Let them come forward right now. This is your time. This is your moment. My righteousness, oh God, how I need. They're coming. You can come too. This is your time. This is your moment. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. They're still coming. They're still coming. You can come too. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. My one defense, my righteousness, oh God. Come on, come on, come on. If that's you, you need to come. Get down here. If it was good enough to raise your hand, it's good enough to come forward. Come on. They're still coming. They're still coming. Come on. There's room for you at the altar. Pray that prayer. Gonna invite Jesus in your heart. Gonna be born again. Okay? Now listen, this is not about the words of your mouth. It's about the prayers of your heart right now. Everybody else is gonna join in with us. Even if you didn't raise your hand, but you're sitting there and you say, man, I should have come. Right now, you can pray in your seat. So there's no distance with God. It's not about a religious activity. This is about the expression of your heart right now. We're gonna pray a simple prayer and say simple phrases. If you have the ability, I want you to repeat them out loud together with me. Put your heart on the Lord. It's the biggest thing right now. We're going to bow our heads once again, close our eyes. Everybody together, join in with us and say these words. Say out loud, say, Father God, I come to you now in Jesus' name. I give you all of my heart and all my life. Come into my heart. Be my Lord, my Savior. Forgive me of all my sin, everything I've ever done wrong, where I've missed the mark and violated your law. Forgive me. Cleanse me, wash me with your blood, and today be my Lord and my Savior. Let it be known that from this day on, I am a Christian. I'm headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. Fill me now with your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise today. Hallelujah. So good, so good, so good. All right, everybody up front, now that you're a Christian, what do you do next? We want to encourage you in your new walk with the Lord. So we have some free information, some free literature, help you to find out about that as well. We want to introduce you to a program. Really, it's more than a program. It's a person, a friend who will come alongside you and teach you some things out of the Bible, help you get strong in the ways of the Lord. Okay, it's easy, it's free, and you need to do it. Right over here to my right, your left, this is Pastor Joel waving at you. Really good guy. Nothing weird goes on. He's going to give you that information, talk to you about that program, take a couple minutes of your time, and then he'll let you come right back out. Your friends and family will wait for you. If you guys will just make a left turn, follow Pastor Joel right this way. Let's give him a hand as they go. Hallelujah.